Professor William McClure has agreed to be our main speaker this evening. And Professor McClure is an assistant professor at Queens College. It's part of the City University of New York. He is from the Department of Classical, Middle Eastern, and Asian Studies at Queens College, as well as at the Graduate School, the Graduate Center at 34th Street. He directs the Japanese language program at Queens College, and he's the author of a book called Using Japanese, A Guide to Contemporary Usage. His work appears as well in journals in language sciences and the Journal for East Asian Linguistics, etc. He is currently organizing the 12th Japanese and Korean Linguistic Conference, which will be held at the CUNY Graduate Center on November 1st to 3rd. In fact, it is a conference that ARI supports. And I'm very, very happy that Professor McClure is with us today. Please give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. I'm going to give you a handout, because linguists always talk with handouts instead of many examples and stuff like that. So, but it will be easy to follow, but I want to have. Okay, so I teach Japanese, and I've taught Japanese for years, and of course the problem with Japanese, or one of the problems, is how to explain why, basically. But I'm also a linguist, and what linguists always try to do is figure out some sort of systematic or consistent way to explain what something means. So we have all these questions, which are, you know, and what is wa? Okay, for those of you who don't know Japanese, it's a little word that goes on the topic of the sentence. Okay, so it tells you what you're talking about. But the problem for speakers of English is that doesn't make any sense, what I just said. Okay, and the question is, you know, so when is wa appropriate? When should you use it? When should you not use it? These kinds of choices. How do you translate it into English? And then, of course, as a teacher, the question is, how do you make any of this clear to students? Okay, because it's an impossible thing to do, really. So to begin, we'll look at some. Oh, you want me to sit closer to it?
Either sit closer or use it.
Well, stand behind. I can't sit and talk. I have to stand and talk. Okay. We'll look at some facts about Japanese and just to get an idea of what wa does, and then we'll look at some of its properties also. So the standard sort of example that people compare is what you see in one, where you have two sentences, Tanaka-san ga gakusei da and Tanaka-san wa gakusei da. Okay, and the only difference between these two sentences is one has a ga and one has a wa. The problem for students of the language is the best translation for both sentences is Tanaka is a student. Okay, so that doesn't help at all with figuring out what it means, you know, so what do you do? Okay, but it's not just a matter of wa versus ga. You see in the second example there, you say keiki wo tabeta versus keiki wa tabeta ga pie wa tabenakatta. Okay, I ate cake, but I didn't eat pie. So here's a case where keiki, which is normally considered the direct object, the thing which is eaten, it can be o or it can be wa also. Okay, and again, the best translation for both of the sentences is I ate cake. So what's the difference between the two things? And the third one, you see a different one, which is I have been to Tokyo. And here, Tokyo in the first sentence is marked with a different particle, ni, which basically means to. But it can also be marked with particle wa. And both of the sentences basically mean I've been to Tokyo. So the question is, what is this doing? Because from an English perspective, it appears to be doing nothing. But in fact, these sentences are very different in Japanese. And so the question is, what is this difference? How do you teach the difference? These kinds of things. Okay? Just so that you know, when people talk about the particles, these little words ga and o, and ni, typically people will say that ga marks the subject of the sentence, whereas o marks the direct object of the sentence, and ni basically means to. So you have these things, but what you see here is that all of these things can also be wa. And so the question is, why would you do this? If, you know, given that you don't do it in English, what's going on? Okay, now one of the standard sorts of definitions of wa, or the way people talk about it, is they say, well, you use wa when the thing has been mentioned already during the course of the conversation, or when it's old information, or when it's given, you know, when it's sort of something that is assumed. But this is clearly false. Okay, so if you look at the first two examples in two, both of these have a wa in them. Otoko wa, there it is. And then the rest of the sentence is irrelevant. This is the first line of some fairy tale. It's a very sort of common way that stories begin in Japanese. There's a wa right at the beginning. There's no previous mention. So it can't be previous mention that's making it happen, you know, that you choose wa. So there's no simple rule like previous mention that makes it work. Okay. Likewise, in the second example, you're changing the topic. And here it's tokoro de konshu matsu wa. Okay, speaking of this weekend, etc., etc., etc. Again, there's been no previous mention, but wa is fine, and in fact normal in this kind of situation. Okay. The flip side is seen in three, or the third example there, where if you were to look at the, you can just look at the English translation, but a long time ago, an old man, marked with ga, lived in the mountains. That old man, this is the second mention, but it's still ga. So this is also possible. So these ideas of previous mention or new mention or whatever, these really don't help you with when you choose ga and when you choose wa. So something else has to be happening. So that's one of, you know, so how do we, where is wa appropriate? The third issue, which is interesting to me, is what is the best translation of wa? How do you translate it into English? Now, we've already seen in the first set of examples that basically you don't have to do anything. That's sort of the best translation. So what do people do? Well, they create these bizarre structures. So they say, Tanaka-san ga gakusei da, this is in three, Tanaka is a student, versus Tanaka-san wa gakusei da, and they will say things like, speaking of Tanaka, he is a student. Okay, so they're setting up a topic in English, okay? As for Tanaka, he is a student. These kinds of constructions. Now, these are sort of okay, but the weirdness is that wa is very, very common in Japanese. And saying something like, speaking of Tanaka, he is a student, is a totally bizarre thing to say in English. So there's no correspondence in terms of how they're used in the two languages. Wa is everywhere in Japanese, but these sorts of bizarre English structures are very bizarre, basically. So they're really not a very good translation. I tell my students that wa should be translated as we see here. So, Tanaka-san wa gakusei da. I'm going to tell you something about Tanaka. Are you ready? Okay, this is what I'm going to say. He is a student. Okay, I mean, I tell my students this because what I've done there with that long string of English is really set up Tanaka as the topic, the thing I'm going to talk about, as opposed to it being the subject of the sentence. The reason that this is important, and you see this in four, is that one difference, or one thing about a topic in Japanese is it's not repeated time and time again, and a subject is. So in four, it's a self-introduction. Hello, my name is William McClure. I'm a student. I'm a sophomore at Queen's College. Okay, in English, we have to have I every time. But in Japanese, if you have watashi wa, watashi wa, watashi wa, with the topic repeated time and time and time again, it's very bizarre. Okay, so the other difference between a topic is that you don't say it again and again and again. You announce what the topic is, and you don't say it anymore. Okay, until you change it. You know, so you can talk about the topic again later on. So it's a very, very different thing from anything that we really have in English. Okay, and that's sort of the first lesson that students have to learn, is that whatever the topic is, it's very, very different from English. It's not repeated in the way that subjects are repeated in English. It's very hard to translate into English. But it's also very, very common in Japanese and in Korean, okay, and in other languages as well. So how do you capture these two kinds of things? Because students of Japanese do all kinds of bad things. They say the topic, you know, they go watashi wa, watashi wa, watashi wa. And that's basically speaking English and Japanese. It's not really speaking Japanese, because it would be a strange sort of thing to do. So you want to keep that problem from happening, and you want, but at the same time, you want it to be understood what's going on with it. Okay. So these are sort of the issues which, you know, which I face, which anyone who tries to teach this to students faces. Okay, and the question is, how can we characterize this? What can we do? Now, okay, so I'm going to talk about that. And this is, it becomes more linguistic-y now, but the linguistics is consistent now with the way that I will tell you what I teach this, okay? I think that English does have topicalization. It does have a good translation for wa. The problem is that it's not a word. Okay, there's no word, there's no phrase that is the translation of wa. Speakers of English topicalize by the way we use intonation. Okay, so when something is not a topic, it's basically not stressed in speech, and we'll see what that means. Okay, you can sort of get this difference to fall out. Okay, now to look at this, I thought about this for a long time, and I was working with a colleague of mine, and I'm going to go over an analysis of sentences in English, okay, and show how this corresponds exactly to whether or not you choose wa or you choose ga, say, to mark a subject, that you get the exact same sorts of things. And what's very interesting is this analysis of English is actually very old. I mean, it was written in the 50s by a professor at Oxford named John Austin, who did all this work on English. And then we've come back and we've looked at this stuff 50 years later and realized that this is exactly the right cut for Japanese, which is really very interesting that the analysis should work exactly like that. So looking at page 2, talking about several things, and there's an important distinction which has to be made. In linguistics, when we talk about language, we talk about syntax, okay, which is basically structure. Okay, what's the grammar? You have subjects, you have objects, you have a verb, you need prepositions, whatever. Those kinds of rules that we all know. Okay? There's also semantics. Now, what is semantics? Semantics is basically meaning. What does a sentence mean? And then there's pragmatics, which is usage. How is a sentence used in a particular context? So syntax and semantics are sort of, you look at a sentence, you know, it is raining. And you decide, okay, that's a good sentence, you know, because it's grammatically well-formed. You can decide that it's a true sentence, or you can decide it's a false sentence. And you look outside now, you know it's a false sentence. Okay, so it's a question of meaning. And a lot of semantics is actually based on this question of truth alone, in sort of the kind of linguistics that I do and other people do. So we would say, as a speaker of English, that you understand the sentence, it is raining, because you can tell if it's true or if it's false. Okay, if you don't speak English, you don't know if the sentence is true or false. Okay, but if you do speak English and you understand the sentence, then you can tell me, well, no, that's not true. Okay, or you can tell me, yes, that is true, but you can make this decision. Okay, now clearly, if you understand a sentence like it is raining, you understand a lot more than that. Okay, there's a lot more than just the question of is the sentence true or is the sentence false. But if you don't know if the sentence is true or false, you don't get anything. I mean, you're really, really, really way off if you can't tell if it's true or false. So that's sort of like the minimum requirement for understanding meaning. And there's a lot more things, but this is what it's based on, that sentences are either true or they're false, and that speakers of a language know if they're true or false. And that's how, sort of one way we know that you're a speaker of a language, because you can make this distinction. We agree when we make these distinctions. Okay, it clearly works. Okay, now these things, syntax and semantics, the other thing to be careful of is, these are properties of what we will call sentences. Okay, now a sentence is just sort of this abstract, you know, it's grammatically correct, it's got words, and it has meaning. And it contrasts with what we would call utterances. Okay, now you have a sentence, which is just sort of a sentence, and an utterance is a sentence, but spoken at a particular time. Okay, so the question, is it raining? When I say it today, right now, it's false. Okay, the utterance, it is raining, is a false utterance at this particular point in time. If tomorrow it's pouring outside and I say the exact same sentence, it is raining, now it's true, if in fact it's raining. So every time I say the words, it is raining, I'm producing a grammatical sentence of English because it follows the rules and it's got the right structure, whatever like that. But each time I say it, it's different whether or not it's true or false. When you put it into a context, it becomes different. I mean, it's different. The truthness or falseness will change every time. Okay, so each time I say it, in some sense, it's the same sentence. But in another sense, it's a different version of the same sentence. Okay, and this is sort of the contrast between what we would call the sentence, sort of abstractly, versus the utterance, which is each time I actually utter the words, say the words, it is rain. Okay, so we have this distinction we have to make. Because this is crucial, because the choice of wa versus ga is not a property of a sentence. It's a property of an utterance. Okay, wa versus ga only makes sense in a particular context. It doesn't make sense sort of abstractly. I mean, one of the things about wa versus ga is that in Japanese, if you have ga in a sentence, and it's a grammatical sentence, you can always put wa there. It's always grammatical. Okay, there's no sentence in Japanese with a particle ga where you can't take the ga and put it a wa there instead. And it's still a fine sentence of Japanese. So that will never affect the grammaticality of it. But it will affect, is the sentence appropriate? Is the sentence inappropriate at that particular time? Okay, so it changes the utterance, but it doesn't change the grammar. Okay, yes?
Talking about the difference, utterance and the expression, mm-hmm. Can you put your personal, because you were talking about structure, mm-hmm. the way it's expressed, can you put your personal judgment, what does it mean, cultural value, why do you put that?
I'm coming to that. I will come to why the choice is actually made. Okay, and we'll see. I mean, but the point is that it's each utterance you have to decide. Do you choose ga here or do you choose wa? Okay. Any sentence in Japanese, if you have ga versus wa, they're both grammatical. They're both acceptable sentences. So the question, as you're asking, is, you know, which one is the right one? But in a particular, it has to be a particular situation to make that decision. Okay, so yeah, that's exactly sort of what I'm coming to. Okay? Okay, so I'm gonna introduce this theory of, it's called a theory of speech acts. Okay, that's what Austin called it. And he used very, very, very simple sentences, okay? And showed that even very, very simple sentences are complicated. Okay, and this is sort of interesting. So you have a sentence like, all of his sentences are things like 1, 2, 4, 6 is a rhombus. Okay, they're all really stupid sentences like that. Okay, but they're all sentences of a, you know, this is a that kind of structure. Okay, that's what he said. So 1, 2, 4, 6 is a rhombus. That is a nuthatch. That is a cherry blossom. These very, very simple kinds of sentences. And then he makes the point that even these very simple sentences are complicated. Okay, they do different things. Okay, they perform different speech acts. They perform different things every time you say them. Okay, now he would say that, he talks about the idea of a match. So you have a match between 1, 2, 4, 6, okay, which is basically just, it's like if I draw an object on the board, you know, I draw an object, here it is, and I say, I call this 1, 2, 4, 6, so I say it's this, basically, this object. Then I have some grammar over here, is a rhombus. Okay, so you have these two things, and the question is, does it match? Okay, is that, I mean, this is issue that when you put this next to this, you get sort of a true statement, is does it make sense? Okay, and that's his question, you know, and if it makes sense, then it's a well-formed sentence. Okay, but the idea is that we're matching an actual object of some kind, okay, to various kinds of predicates. Okay, and the sentences we get are well-formed if it makes sense, if it agrees. Okay, so that's sort of how the sentences are good or are they bad. But his point is that matching is not symmetrical. Okay, so I can, if I have this and this, I can have this, and I can look for different predicates. It's a rhombus, it's a square, it's a circle. Okay, and I can find the one that it matches to. Okay, alternatively, I can have is a rhombus, and I can have a circle, I can have a square, I can have a triangle, and I can take this, and I have to find which one of these it matches to. Okay, so that this one sentence, 1, 2, 4, 6, is a rhombus, In fact, it sort of has these two functions, okay, that I can take, in some sense, I can take this side for granted and match it to the right predicate. Or I can take this side for granted and match it to the right object. Okay, and then when every time, and how do you get this? Well, you get it, it's very clear with like questions. Okay, so if I say to you, which item is a rhombus? Okay, which item is a rhombus? That question is taking rhombus, or is a rhombus for granted. Okay, I'm looking for a thing that's called a rhombus. I want to know which one. So I'm asking you this one of these things. I'm asking that as an answer. Okay, but I can ask a different question, which is here, and say, you know, what is item 1, 2, 4, 6? What is this? Okay, take this for granted, and then produce the right predicate on this side. Okay, this is a very, I mean, it's a very subtle sort of difference, but I want you, I mean, basically, you have these two parts, this side and this side. You can take one for granted and produce the other side, or you can take this side for granted and produce this side, and you can do these two things with any sentence in English. Okay, and you see these in these things. What is item 1, 2, 4, 6? It is a rhombus. Okay, there I've given you the item, and I've asked you to describe it. Okay, or which item is a rhombus? There I've given you this is a rhombus. Okay, and I need to know which one is the rhombus. I'm asking you to produce the item. So you can do these two things. And this is called direction of fit. Okay, and basically the question is, if you have a predicate, you can go this way or you can go this way. You can match the item to the predicate or you can match the predicate to the item. Okay? There's also, so that's one thing. But the point only is that matching is not symmetrical. You don't take two things equally and test. Okay, you pick this one and you test things against it, or you pick this side and you test things against it, so you do this asymmetrical kind of thing. The other thing is called onus of match, and I'm not going to talk about this because it's not important, but it's funny, because if you look at these two sentences at the bottom, John is as evil as Satan, that's a great sentence and it's sort of funny, but if you say Satan is as evil as John, is sort of funny, it should make you laugh because it's a silly thing to say. And onus of match sort of explains why that's funny. I mean, it's a funny observation, but it's got to do with, basically the question is John evil enough to be Satan? And that's an okay question, but to say, is Satan evil enough to be John? That's a weird kind of question. I mean, that's another way of looking at things. Okay, so what's important though is this idea of matching, and this idea of you can take this side, you can take this side and match something here, you can take this side and match something there. Okay. Now, if you look at the top of page 3, you have these questions in English. Okay, and what's important here, well, we'll talk about what's important. So, Austin says that with a single sentence of English, you can actually do 4 things. Okay, that a single sentence of English can actually accomplish 4 different kinds of things. Okay, and he calls these things, they're here, calling, describing, exemplifying, classing. That's really not that important. But if you look at calling, I say to you, what is that bird called? Okay, what do we call that bird? In the question which I've asked you, there is a bird. Okay, here it is.
He's our little bird. Whatever, I can't really draw birds. There it is.
What's that bird called? Okay, so I'm asking you, I'm taking the bird for granted and asking you to produce a predicate to describe the bird. Tell me, it's a nuthatch, it's a robin, it's a whatever it is. Okay, so the answer is, that's a nuthatch. Fine. Okay. But I could also say to you, looking at the same bird, please describe that bird. Tell me something about that bird. Just describe it. You say, well, it's a nuthatch. It's the same answer. Okay? But in some sense, you've done something different. Okay? In the first case, you gave me its name. And in the second case, you sort of gave me a description of it. So it's a nuthatch, meaning it's little and it's brown and it flaps around and it doesn't climb up trees, et cetera, et cetera. You sort of, you know, described it in different ways. But in both cases, we have an object. And in both cases, I'm asking you for a predicate to describe the object. Okay? We can flip it around the other way in exemplifying and classing. So I can say, give me an example of a nuthatch. Now, what I'm saying to you is I don't know what a nuthatch is, okay? But I want something where when I look at it, you tell me this is a nuthatch. Okay, so I'm saying to you, you have many birds.
Many birds. There's a whole bunch of birds. They're all birds. They're stupid-looking birds.
So give me an example of a nuthatch. So I don't have the object. I want the object. And you say, well, that's a nuthatch. Okay, you produce the object. Okay, and the last thing here is, which of these is a nuthatch? Again, I have a predicate in mind, is a nuthatch. But I don't know which object is the right object. So I'm asking you to produce the object again. Okay, and you say, well, this one's the nuthatch, whatever it happens to be. Okay, so the point going back and forth with the calling and describing, I have a bird, I see the bird, and what I want to know basically is, can you tell me what the bird is called? Give me a name for it. Give me a predicate to describe this bird. Okay, the other two questions, I have an idea in my head. It is a nuthatch, but I don't know which objects are the nuthatch, so I want you to give me an object. Say this bird is a nuthatch, that bird is not the nuthatch, whatever. So I'm going the other way, so I'm going back and forth these two ways. Okay. So in this sense, I'm using the exact same sentence, this is a nuthatch, to do different kinds of things, to give me different kinds of information, because I'm asking different kinds of questions. I have different kinds of questions, but the same words in English answer all four questions. Okay? And there's clearly, you know, there are different sorts of things are going on in the various questions which I'm asking. So the same sentence can do many different things. And these many different things are what are called speech acts, okay? That I can ask a certain kind of question, I can ask for certain kinds of information, whatever. These are what are called speech acts. And his point is that a single sentence in English can do four different things, okay? But in English, it's one sentence, four different things. Now, the interesting thing about this analysis is when you look at Japanese, you see that there is a difference. Okay, and that's what's interesting about this. Okay, that you ask the same sorts of questions in Japanese, but then you get different answers. Okay, sometimes you get wa, sometimes you get ga. But it's exactly parallel. So if you were to ask the questions in Japanese, what is that flower called? Okay, and in Japanese that's, you know, anohana wa nante iu hana desu ka? So there's a wa in the question, and in the answer, it's anohana wa, that flower wa is the cherry blossom, or something like that. Okay. So in this kind of question, a calling, what is that flower called? I have the flower, here it is, you know, and you look at it and I go, what is that flower called? And you say, that flower wa is the cherry blossom, is a daisy, is whatever it happens to be. So you use wa. What is wa doing? Well, wa is telling us that we have the flower. And what we want to know is the other part of the sentence. Okay, what's it called? What's its name? Okay, we're asking for the predicate. Okay, please describe that flower. Again, we have the flower in front of us. There it is. So anohana wa, you know, please describe it. Okay, and you describe it as anohana wa sakura desu yo. It's the cherry blossom. It's the same sort of thing. So this is, within the context of just this sentence, the flower is taken for granted. And our point is that basically within a sentence, when the noun part is taken for granted, when the flower is taken for granted, that's when you get wa. Okay? Now turn it around. Give me an example of a cherry blossom. I don't know anything about cherry blossom. So there are a whole bunch of flowers. Which one is a cherry blossom? Okay. Normal Japanese answer, this flower, ga, is a cherry blossom. Okay. The way that I've asked the question, is a cherry blossom, is what's been taken for granted. Okay. Because that's what I need a cherry blossom. So you have to give me an example of a cherry blossom. Okay. So you say, kono hana ga sakura desu yo. This one is the cherry blossom, okay, with the ga. Okay? Likewise, if I have a whole bunch of flowers and like there's all kinds of things and I don't know what's going on, I say, which one of these is the cherry blossom? Okay? Dore ga sakura desu ka? Which ga is the cherry blossom? And the answer is, ma kore ga, this one ga is the cherry blossom. Okay? So in these kinds of questions, it's the predicate which I'm taking for granted. Okay, I need to know cherry blossom. So which one is cherry blossom? And when you answer that question, you use ga. Okay, if I'm asking you to describe this, to name this, I'm taking this for granted, and that's when you get what? Okay? So what you're seeing here basically is this notion of direction of fit. Okay, that we have an item and we have a predicate. Okay, and we can take the item for granted and ask for the predicate, or we can take the predicate for granted and ask for the item. When we take the item for granted, it's wa. Okay, that tells us we're taking the item for granted. We're assuming it in the course of our conversation. Okay. When we take the predicate for granted, we get ga
over here.
Okay, and that's really all there is to it. I mean, it's got nothing to do with previous sentences. It has nothing to do with sentences which follow. It has nothing to do with anything except what it is we're trying to accomplish within this one sentence. Okay, it's a speech act. Which thing are we taking for granted? Which thing are we sort of trying to get people to answer? Okay, now, and you see this difference again by the way you ask the question in English. Okay, so, you know, what is this flower called? This flower, what? Okay, versus, you know, which flower is a cherry blossom? And you can ask different kinds of questions, and with this you get different kinds of answers in English. And students can kind of see this. The other thing that you realize about English is that, in fact, we make a distinction, okay? So if I say, you know, what is that bird called, or what is that flower called, the normal sort of English answer is, well, that's a cherry blossom. Okay, if there's stress in the sentence, it's on the answer, the new part, the phrase is a cherry blossom. Okay, if I say, which of these flowers is a cherry blossom, because I'm really confused, you say, this one is the cherry blossom. Okay, the stress in English goes on the part of the sentence which is produced, okay, which is new. And the lack of stress goes on the part which is given, okay, which is taken for granted. So, in Japanese, you have wa versus ga, given or produced. In English, given is associated with lack of stress, okay? Produced is associated with stress in the sentence. So the reason that this is so hard for students of the language is these are completely different kinds of things, okay? People don't even think of stress as grammar. They don't think of it as part, you don't think about stress at all, basically. I mean, it just happens and it just sort of works, but you people don't really think about it. So you can't say, well, this word is wa, this word is ga, these kinds of things. You have to say, the way that you say this corresponds to wa, versus the way that you say this corresponds to ga, okay? Because there is stress or there isn't stress. And I'm exaggerating when I say it, you know, so this is a cherry blossom versus this is a cherry blossom. Okay, I mean, it's exaggerated, but it's exactly the right kind of thing, and it makes no reference at all to sort of all the things that people talk about when they talk about wa and ga. Okay, because I mean, for me personally, I think it's completely this sort of stressed item. You know, what's the right question? And there are two kinds of questions, and then you get different kinds of answers. And in one question, you know, it's a wa, and the other question, it's a ga. But the two questions flip what you take for granted and what you assume. Okay, and the normal answer flips. Okay, the part that is stressed also flips. Okay, so this is the insight that we have, and it's a strange thing because it sort of vaguely or sort of indirectly is talking about the question of translation. Okay, I mean, to me, one of the very interesting things when you look at, say, Japanese and English, you look at any languages which are as different as Japanese and English, you know, sort of the old days or the old school as well. If you're speaking a foreign language, you learn all the words, you learn the translations of all the words, and you learn the grammar, and you just put them in the different order, and it's fine, okay? But it's crazy when you try to go from English to Japanese, Chinese, I mean, anything spoken on the entire continent of Asia. None of these things will work. I mean, it's a complete disaster. And when I talk to my students, what I tell them to try to do is, okay, you've said something in Japanese. What does the world look like based on what you just said? Okay, now describe that in English. Okay, But that you, because you can't just go word, I mean, word for word is a disaster. It's just not going to happen, okay? And this, and it raises the question, you know, of, you know, so what is the best translation? Is it the translation where the words match the closest? Is it the translation where the grammar matches the closest? Is it the translation which is sort of the most equivalent in the other language? Now, the thing about, I said at the beginning, is that wa is very, very common in Japanese. Okay, you have to make this choice, wa versus ga. It's very, very common. Every time you say a sentence with a subject, you have to say one or the other. This actually corresponds exactly to stress in English. Every time you say a sentence in English, you emphasize some things, you leave other things out. Okay, if you go back to the self-introduction, you know, when I introduce myself, I say, I'm William McClure, I'm a student, I'm a sophomore at Queen's College. When I'm speaking, there's no stress on the word I, ever. And if there was, it would be very weird. Okay, if I said, hello, I am William McClure, I am a student, I am, I mean, it would be completely wrong. But that's exactly the effect of putting ga, 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 ga all the way through, which would also be crazy. Okay, so if you go through this way back and forth, or if I ask you, you know, so, who likes sushi? And you say, I like sushi. Okay, I mean, I put the stress basically on the part of the sentence which doesn't respond to what you've asked me. So in English, you see these effects, but we do it with stress. And in Japanese, it's realized as mismatches between ga and wa. You've asked some ga question, you answer it with a wa. You do these very sorts of bizarre things. So in Japanese, it's grammaticized with this choice of particles. Okay. In English, it's stress. In both languages, it's very common. In both languages, you in fact can't speak without making the choice. Okay, you actually have to say it every time you say a sentence, this kind of thing. So to me, this is the correct translation. And it's very hard for students because they don't think of it, they don't think of intonation as anything, basically. Okay, so it's sort of a puzzle in that respect. I can go over, do you have a question? Yeah.
For example, does Japanese do stresses as well?
They do it as well. And if you do stress, you certainly don't stress the wa thing, basically. I mean, if you can make things even stronger Japanese by stressing things as well. And when you do, it has to be the new part. It has to be like Englishness, basically. It would be very strange to stress the topic. Although, you can do it to get sort of contrastive kinds of effects. But then that's a whole separate question. Okay, of how you get contrast and these kinds of things. Yes?
Following up on that question, in English, on the written form, you want to stress something, you italicize.
Right, you can
Japanese,
do that.
Do you italicize as well?
No, you just make these kinds of choices. I mean, if I see italics in English, I think it's really, really stressed. Okay, you can do that in Japanese. You can do funny things, you know, when you're writing to underline or to put a double, there are various sorts of devices that will have similar effects to English italics. I personally think that, I mean, I'm just saying, I think when you italicize in English that it sort of overly stresses in some sense. I think that the kind of stress, differences in stress between wa and ga, the problem is that basically when you write English, there's no difference. Okay, so if you go back to the first sentences, you know, Tanaka-san wa gakusei da, Tanaka-san ga gakusei da, the normal English translation is Tanaka is a student. Okay, but in fact, the translations are Tanaka is a student versus Tanaka is a student. But in our writing system, we don't write that distinction. I mean, you could, but most people don't most of the time. You know, but it's sort of, that's why, I mean, the italics is sort of exaggerated to that. But that difference in the way I spoke those two sentences, we don't put in our orthography. So we don't think it, I mean, this is part of the reason I think we don't think it exists, because we don't write it down any place normally. Does that make sense? I mean, just these very relatively subtle differences in how you say a sentence correspond to the difference. But you don't write it normally. Okay, unless you really exaggerate it. Are there any other questions? Does this make sense? Yeah.
I don't know if you're going to go on, or this is the question time.
Well, I have more to say, but you can ask questions.
Japanese is one of those few languages
with
male speech and female speech differ quite considerably.
Right.
Is there a difference in usage between male and female?
Not that I can remember.
about between child and adults?
No.
Or hierarchy?
There is, not for Wa'anga, no. Not in terms of, I mean, there's certain things, okay, so for example, it's pretty easy in Japanese to not say wa, okay, to actually omit it from your speech. And that is something which different kinds of people tend to do more or less, okay? So it comes across as less formal, let's say, when you omit certain kinds of things. So there will be differences in what is omitted or how careful you are when you speak, but in terms of this sort of taking this for granted versus not taking it for granted distinction, as far as I've ever looked at, there's no gender distinction. That's not where the gender distinction lies, and it's not a social distinction either. I mean, people use this part of the language the same, basically.
How about a class? Poor people?
Now, as far as I know, there's no distinction. Not here. Not with
the Japanese is very strong.
No, there's tremendous, yeah. I mean, this is not to say Japanese does not have the means to express tremendous differences in social status, okay? But it tends to be the content words, okay? So the names, you know, what do you use a normal verb? Do you use an honorific verb? Do you use a normal adjective? Do you use an honorific adjective? Do you speak? There are a lot of, most, basically all verbs in Japanese have these different levels that you can reflect on. So do you use those or do you not use those? There is the claim, there's a traditional claim that women speak more correctly than men do. Okay, that women speak more grammatically than men do. Okay, it's a standard claim made about like English and French. It's a claim made about Western languages because it's been studied in Japanese. In Japanese, because, okay, the reason behind this supposedly is the people with power, the men, okay, can be freer, okay, can be sloppier. And the people who are weak have to be more careful, the women. Okay, that's the standard sort of analysis of it. But it's actually been looked at in Japanese and the opposite is true. Okay, if you look at the way women speak Japanese versus the way men speak Japanese, the women are actually more innovative. They do more things with the language, and the men tend to be more conservative, and no one knows what this means. I mean, it actually means the women actually run Japan, which is probably true. But there's this, I mean, it contradicts sort of the standard findings based on sort of Western models that people say about that language, and no one really knows why. It's true. But these are reflections of, you know, which vocabulary is used, how careful is the speech, how grammatical is the speech, how conservative is the speech. As far as I know, it is not reflected in these kinds of choices. Okay, because this is not, these kinds of choices are not a reflection of social status, they're a reflection of what I'm asking, okay, and what I'm taking for granted in this sort of communicative kind of thing. Okay, whether or not you insist on saying wa all the time, or you are willing to admit it, or you know omit it, that could be a social decision. Okay, the people who are careful never omit it; people who are less careful omit it all the time. This kind of thing. Yes.
That's in the old traditional, old-fashioned sort of Chinese, always use very as if not sure as a. I don't want to be offensive, you know, to sound to you very aggressive. Mm-hmm. And it's a Japanese, wa, mm-hmm. That's a very definitive, and a ga is a question, so that should we go to the movie? Let's go to the movie.
Right.
Should we go to the movie?
Yeah. No.
Let's go to the movie, right. Wa.
No, I actually agree with you, right. So if, I mean, it's the kinds of things you say may actually reflect what kind of person you are. Okay, so this is, for example, in Japanese, polite Japanese speech, you never ask difficult questions. I mean, these kinds of things, you know, that in polite context, everything is very easy to talk about, kind of thing. And yes, that can actually come out reflecting in what kinds of sentences you use. Okay, do you ask a lot of questions? Well, basically, asking a lot of questions is not particularly polite because it puts the other person on the spot. If you're not using questions, you're not going to use ga very much, okay? Because ga basically is asking questions about this, and whatever, because this is what I want to know, Okay. So yes, I think that you're right that there may be an effect that comes through this way, but it's a speech act effect. Okay. It's saying that certain kinds of speech acts are easier, are polite. Okay. Other kinds of speech acts are less polite because they put people on the spot, because they demand information, these kinds of things. And that difference is then reflected in which particle you use. But I don't think that the particle itself, that you can say this is a polite particle or this is sort of a rude particle. I don't really think that that's, I think that that's too, it's too close. This is actually different from Korean. In Korean, it actually is different. In Korean, there's several ways to say ga. And some of them are polite, some of them are less polite. So in Korean, the honorific system is reflected in the particles as well as in the names of the nouns and the verbs and all those kinds of things. It's much more, there's actually more of it in Korean than there is in Japanese. Because a word like ga, this is just considered sort of grammatical. So it doesn't have, you know, polite versus non, you know, rude sort of in it as part of it. It's not felt to be that way. Just a couple of things. I mean, I'll stop whenever I'm supposed to stop, but I don't know when I'm supposed to stop either. Just facts about wa that everybody's supposed to know. So on page 4, number 5, 誰は入ってきたの? Who wa came in? This is bad. You know, well, why is this bad? Well, it should be obvious why it's bad now. Okay, because wa says this is what's given. But the word 誰 says who. It says, I don't know. Okay, and that is a conflict. So you can't put questions with wa, because the interpretation of wa is in conflict with the interpretation of the question word. Okay, and so they're just out, basically. That's very easy. There's another fact about Japanese. It's called the matrix distribution of wa. What this means is that basically when you have wa in a Japanese sentence, it's always in the top part of the sentence. So if we have a sentence like, okay, John ate the cake which Bill made. Okay, there's John ate the cake which Bill made. This, there are two sentences here. There's the main sentence, John ate the cake, and then there is the which Bill made, which is a relative clause. But it's a sentence describing the cake. Okay, and what you see in Japanese is that it's basically impossible to put wa in the inside sentence. So I can't say, John ga biru wa tsukutta keiki o tabeta. Okay, meaning John ate the cake which Bill wa made. Okay, wa can't be in the lower, in the inside sentence. It always has to be in the main sentence. Okay. Why should this be? Okay, and you know, sort of the traditional answers don't tell you. The discourse reasons don't tell you. Why is this basically ungrammatical in Japanese to put this here? And the idea here we have is that, remember that particle wa is used to indicate what is given. If you have a particle wa, then you have something which is given before the wa, and then the other part of the sentence is what's produced, is what's new. Okay. Now, at the beginning I made a difference between syntax, which is sort of structure, and speech act theory, which is the utterance. Okay, and I said that these are different sorts of things. Now, they're very different in the sense that a sentence can contain a sentence, okay, because a sentence is just a piece of structure. So you can have a big sentence with a little sentence inside of it, and that's fine. Okay, but you can't have an utterance inside an utterance. Okay, an utterance is the thing, okay, and there's nothing inside of an utterance except words, okay, but there's no other utterance that's sort of inside the utterance, okay? Now, normally, sentences, the structure of a sentence and the structure of the utterance are the same. In simple cases, you have one sentence and it's one utterance and everything is happy. And we have the sentence, so we have a structure. You know, where you say blah, 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 and then you have a wa, and you have blah, blah, blah. So this is, we're saying that this is given, this is produced, this is the structure of the utterance. But in most normal cases, in simple cases, it's also the structure of the sentence. Okay, they always correspond. But it's because utterances can't, and in the normal case, it's always a split right there. Okay, when the wa is on the given thing, the given is always first, the produced is always second. Okay, the wa says this is given, so it says everything on this side is given, everything else is produced. This is sort of a normal utterance structure. Okay, and in the simple utterance cases, the syntax is exactly the same. Okay, so the first part of the syntax is going to be over here, and the second part is going to be over here. And so you have a match, basically, between the utterance and the structure. Okay, but because this has to be first, it's also going to appear very high in the sentence. It's going to be first in the structure as well. Okay, which is basically the same thing as saying it's going to be in the matrix clause. Okay, if it wasn't in the matrix clause, it would have to be like down here somewhere. It couldn't be first. It would have to be second or third or something. It would have to be someplace else. Okay, to be inside. But if it's down here, it's not here anymore. It's a mismatch then between what's going on in the utterance and what's going on in the syntax. Okay, so basically it's because the utterance has to look like this. Okay, when it matches the syntax, it forces this part of the syntax to be the given part of the syntax. Okay, and if you put a wa down here, okay, suddenly we're splitting it someplace else. Okay, and we're saying produced, you know, given, produced, or something like that. And this is not an utterance. There is no utterance that has this structure. Okay, the utterance always is basically something, something, wah, and then the rest is produced. Okay, so this would be create a mismatch between syntax and utterance. And that's basically why it's bad. Okay, it's because it's not interested in the structure, it's interested in the utterance, what the utterance looks like. And it's very simple. Okay, it just says, here it is, and everything on that side is given. Here it is, everything on this side is produced. Nothing else. Okay. And when it matches the syntax, that's the side where the wa is, that's the top, the beginning of the sentence, and this is the rest. Okay, and if you try to put a wa down here, you get messed up. Because suddenly now we have produced, given, produced, and various sorts of bizarre things which don't count, which are bad utterances. They don't work. Okay. So there's a weirdness there because the utterance is weird. Not because the syntax is weird necessarily, but the utterance is weird. Okay, it doesn't make sense, the kind of thing that you're saying. Okay. The last thing I'll say, and then I'll stop, I'll keep going, but I'll stop too, is, I mean, there's all this question, if you look at the literature on wa, there's a huge amount of discussion about what's called discourse structure. Okay, what people are always saying is, well, you have something over here and it's marked with ga, blah, 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 and then over here you see it again, and because you see it again, you mark it with wa. Okay, but this is another sentence, you know, so you have one sentence. You have a sentence, this A appears, it's marked with ga the first time, blah, 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 blah. You have a period, and it appears again, and when it appears again, it's marked with wa, blah, 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 blah. Okay, so this is, when we talk about discourse structure, we're talking about the structure of many, many sentences, okay, across a series of sentences, across a paragraph, across a story, this kind of thing. And there are these, you know, so this is this rule, okay, when you have the same thing appears a second time, it's marked with wa, that sort of rule, is sort of a discourse kind of rule. Now, we've already seen that's not true. And in fact, if you look at when people discuss this, they're, you know, people are realizing you get all the patterns. You get this versus this, and you have wa, then you do it again with wa. Sometimes you get this one, sometimes you get wa over here, sometimes you get ga then the second time, sometimes you get ga, sometimes you get ga again. I mean, people have finally realized that in fact, this observation is basically false. Okay, that there are these different sorts of patterns. Each pattern has a different effect. Okay. And so it's impossible to say that wa is defined by these patterns. Okay, it has to be the other way around. Okay, that the patterns are defined by whether or not you choose wa or you choose ga. Okay, does this make sense to everybody? I mean, it's this whole notion of discourse defining whether or not you choose wa or ga has got to be completely backwards. Because all of these patterns exist. And the meaning of the pattern or the implication of the pattern is a function of, okay, did I choose God twice, or did I choose Wah first and then God? Did I choose, you know, which one did I choose? Okay. And this fits with what we're saying, because we're making the claim that Wah, the choice of Wah, or the choice of God, is something which is determined as a speech act. It's determined, which means it's determined on one utterance. Okay, every time you make a statement in Japanese, you have to choose Ga or Wa. And by making that choice, you're making some claim about what's going on. You're setting up what's given, what's produced, etc. within a single sentence. Okay? Well, here we have two sentences. So what have I done? Okay, here I have something and I've produced it. Okay, then the next time, I'm now taking it for granted because I've already produced it. Okay, but now I'm taking it for granted. Fine. What am I doing here? I'm taking it for granted. Okay? I'm still taking it for granted. Okay, what am I doing? I'm sort of reminding you what I'm talking about. Okay, I haven't turned it into something else. I was taking it for granted here. I'm still taking it for granted. And I'm sort of reminding you that this is what I'm doing. Okay? What am I doing here? I'm taking it for granted. Then what am I doing? Suddenly I'm not taking it for granted. Okay, why would I do that? Who knows? I mean, it's supposed to be a theatrical effect where you take something for granted and then suddenly you stop taking it for granted, and that puts a lot of stress on it. Suddenly there's emphasis on it because you stop taking it for granted. Okay, but that effect occurs because you have a sequence of sentences. Okay, here, I don't take it for granted. I still don't take it for granted. What's the effect of that? It tends to put a huge amount of stress on the thing you're not taking for granted. I mean, it's a separate kind of effect. But these various patterns occur because of the meaning of Wa and Ga within the sentence. Okay, and then you set up sequences of them and you get different sorts of effects. Okay, but and it can't be the other way around. It doesn't make sense for it to be the other way around. Okay? Another interpretation here, by the way, is that, like, what if I do this? A Wa, B Wa, what am I doing there? I'm changing the subject. I'm changing the topic I'm talking about. So if you have different wah-wahs with different elements, you could be changing the subject. You can be bringing something back up that you talked about before. There's a whole series of things that one could potentially be doing over a sequence of sentences. But none of these things define wah and ga. It's the other way around. Okay, the meaning of wah in a given sentence, the meaning of ga in a given sentence, sequences of those things give you discourse. Okay, that's how it has to be. But if you look at the linguistic literature on this, it's always viewed the other way around. People say, well, you have these long structures and you have these waga 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 kinds of patterns. What's going on? Blah 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 blah. Okay, as opposed to this sort of looking at. So to me, it makes much more sense. That's sort of more pleasing to me. You know, so the notions, for example, of old and new information, these are discourse notions. They're not, it's not wa versus ga. It's what's the previous sentence versus what's the new sentence, these kinds of things. Okay. Shall I stop? I'll stop. It's okay. I mean, there are other facts, too. I mean, there are other facts about Japanese that sort of follow from this. They're sort of interesting. But you see the point, I think, and you can actually go through the literature on wa and explain everything. Okay, so the next thing is, when you have a negative sentence in Japanese, you usually say wa. Why should that be? Well, it turns out there's a reason for it. Okay, there's the next thing is that when you are making a general statement in Japanese, like all birds have wings, that kind of sentence is almost always all birds wa have wings. Okay, and why should that be? And that also will fall out from this kind of thing. And then the last thing that was supposed to do is you say, like, you know, John ate cake and Bill ate sushi. So you have this contrast between John and Bill, and you should get wa on both of those things with contrast, okay? And that's also true. I mean, that will also follow from the kinds of things. So in the full analysis of this, we've gone through the literature on wa and sort of shown how the various things that are supposed to happen, how they can follow from this kind of analysis rather than the traditional sorts of analyses. Okay, so that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, I think that there may be some questions.
Yes, ask questions.
Yes. On the whole, do the Japanese use wan or gan?
Wan, much, much more. I mean, this is one of the basic problems, is that if you ask a Japanese person, give me a sentence, there's always a wa in it, okay, out of the blue, you know, and it makes no sense if wa is supposed to be previous mention, okay, but it's, you know, so sentences out of context in Japanese always have wa in them. And the other thing is that wa is used, for example, when we're speaking, today wa. Okay, so whenever you're speaking, you're setting up some restriction, whether it be a person or a time frame or something, but it's very unusual to talk without any of those restrictions. So the first thing we do is we set up the restriction, which is wa, and then we go on. So if you actually listen, there's a huge amount of wa, and a lot less ga and o and those kinds of things actually.
More using wa.
Yeah.
As you see, is Japanese the homogeneous society?
Well, do I think it's a homogeneous society? I think they are a homogeneous society.
But Japanese is a very interesting country. You know, when things were looks homogeneous,
right, right.
When there's something happened,
right.
They're very polarizing.
Right, no, I believe that that's
political,
true.
Politically, so extreme,
yeah.
Murder,
right.
No crime at all. But once it happened, just like a root anthropologist, Rose Benedict, mm-hmm. wrote a book mm-hmm. on sword, and and also another thing is very interesting. From what you see, they have their own syntax, their own semantics. The foreign culture is very hard to penetrate.
No, well, I think part of the reason is we don't know what it means. I mean, that's part of the puzzle.
It's coding their own code.
Right. It's very hard to translate it to English, and so it looks really, really weird or very difficult to understand. I don't really think it is hard, okay, but it's hard to figure out how to translate it, you know, to figure out what it is that's being expressed. So it makes it look weird or obscure.
I have a question. On page 5, mm-hmm. you bird walk and fly, right?
Yeah.
Then tobenai.
Right.
Is why we ask the question and that only the answer, or just have to
what this is actually an example of. I mean, one of the points here is that, okay, the claim is that basically, when you have a negative answer in Japanese, you put wa on it. That's supposed to be what's going on. In fact, that's not true. Okay, I can ask for